It was pretty awesome, guys. Welcome, RC Hill, to the library. How are you today?
Good.
Good.
Awesome.
I would like to welcome you to our fifth Book Lovers Day, and today we're excited that you are here. We have with us an author all the way from New York. It's Bruce Goldstone.
Is standing beside me.
And I wanted to tell you just a little bit about him. So he has written over a dozen books. That's a lot of books, isn't it? And he likes to write about math. So anything that's numbers, right? He also gets to help pick all of the cool pictures in his books, which is fun if you know anything about the books, right? So today, Bruce is going to talk to you about how much fun that you can have with numbers and estimating. Do you all know what estimating is?
Yeah.
Okay.
So,
Bruce Goldstone, thank you.
Howdy, everybody. Thanks. But I really do want to, I think I heard a little bit of a dip in enthusiasm when she said math. Everybody thinks of math as something really strict and rigid, and oh, you have to have the right answer. Well, the thing I love about math is that you don't always have to have the right answer. Don't tell your teacher. But sometimes you can play with numbers just like you play with words or play with blocks or play with anything. Numbers can really be fun. And this is something that I've done all of my life since I was your kid, your age. When I was a little kid, I used to spend a lot of time just estimating. I taught myself a lot of these things, and I decided to put it into a book. So this was my first book on this, was called Great Estimations. Now, I'm sure a lot of you have seen jelly beans in a jar, and you've had to guess how many were in the jar, right? So I taught myself some strategies that were going to help me figure out, well, how many jelly beans really are in the jar? So the first thing I want to do is, well, we're going to look here. About, you're going to hear me say about a whole lot. About how many sheep do you see? Now, no counting, I won't see any fingers going around. Yeah, what do you think?
120.
120? Anybody else? What do you think?
About 1,000.
About 1,000? Okay, how about you?
10,000.
10,000? Okay, how about you?
103.
103, and how about you?
130.
130. Those are all estimates. There's no question, that's all an estimate. Some of them are pretty good, some of them might be a little far off, but we're going to learn some strategies to see about how many sheep. Now, I don't really care how many sheep. It's not an important question, it's just a fun question. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to start training your eyes to look at groups of numbers. What does the number 10 look like? All of these things here are groups of 10. You can see there's, what do you see 10 of? What do you see 10 of?
Pretzels.
10 pretzels and 10
pencils.
And what do you see 10 of?
Pipe cleaners.
Pipe cleaners, exactly. And what do you see 10 of?
Cars.
10
cars.
Cars, 10 cars, exactly. So those are all 10s. Now this is one of the things that Tina was saying. I didn't take this picture, but I put the picture in order. I collected all of the things and I put them all in order. And what you'll see here, yes, in all of my books, if you see the pretzels, the caramels, the peppermints, I also ate all of the food after I put the things in order, so no food went uneaten. So that's what 10 looks like. This is also 10. Those are just 10 pennies. Now, something I didn't have a chance to put in the book is it doesn't matter what the position is. That's still 10. This is 10 this way. It doesn't matter how they look. That's still 10. So your eyes are getting used to looking at that's a group of 10. Still 10 pennies. This is still 10 pennies. And that's still 10 pennies. They're very small now, but it doesn't make any difference. Size is, we're talking about the number of pennies. So you got 10 big pennies, 10 little pennies. The next, we call these benchmarks, if you want the fancy word for it, is 100. This is what 100 looks like. So you get your eye is getting used to the idea. Here are, What do we see up in the corner? There's 100. What's in this long line? These are, actually, it's a little hard to see in this. They're pom-poms. They're little pom-poms that you would glue on. What did I eat 100 of? Exactly. So that's 100. Now here we have, back to our pennies. That's 100 pennies, which is also a dollar. Very good. Does it matter if you split it up?
No.
Not at all. Does it matter if you lump them in a corner?
No.
Nope, still 100. You can make a little frame out of it. It's still 100. Now, up from 100 is 1,000. These show you what 1,000 looks like. There's 1,000 beans. There's 1,000 beads in that necklace. There's 1,000 paper clips, and that's one giant paperclip chain of 1,000 paper clips, and that's 1,000 letters across the page. Now, I think we'll have this is 1,000 pennies. Doesn't always have to be a square. It can be a rectangle. This, do you see how teeny they are? This is 10,000 pennies. So now our eyes are getting used to what these groups look like. And this is how we can start to apply this. Here, we see 10 cherries and 100 cherries, right? Now this is a pint, that's another measurement, a pint of cherries. When you look at that, do you think there's more than 10 cherries?
Yes.
Pretty clearly there's more than 10 cherries. Do you think there's more than 100?
No.
No. I don't think so. I think when you look at that, it's pretty clear that the 100 bunch of cherries looks bigger than that. So what estimate might we come up for how many cherries in a pint? What do you think? 60 sounds good. What do you think? 45 sounds good. What about you? 70? And what about you? 30? 30 sounds a little low to me. For this group over here, do you see how close this looks to the 100? I think 30 is a little low. What do you think?
44
could be. So these are all, we've gotten a lot better at our estimating. Now, I want to show you one little trick. These are the cherries that I put in this book. Now, what do you notice? I wrote this book about 5 years ago. These are the exact same cherries. What do you think would happen to these cherries? What do you think?
They spoiled.
Well, they should have spoiled, shouldn't they? But do cherries usually make that noise? No. These are fake. These are plastic cherries. A lot of times when you see food in picture books, it can't be real food. The lights are really bright. So when you take a really good photograph, the cherry will look terrible. And a plastic cherry actually looks more like a real cherry than a real cherry does. So that's just, I like to show you some little secrets like that. This is another example of using your eye training. You've got 100 pennies, and here we have 500. This here is a pound, that weighs a pound of pennies, which, as it happens, is usually how banks measure pennies. They don't count them out. They measure how much they weigh, and then they tell you how much the pennies are worth. So, do you think a pound of pennies, do you think it's got more than 100 pennies in it?
Yeah.
Do you think it has more than 500?
No.
Pretty clearly, it doesn't have more than 500. So what might you estimate the pound of pennies to be worth? Let's get over here. What do you think? 300? Sounds good to me. What do you think?
350?
What do you think?
About 30.
30 again. 30, we're coming up with 30. That sounds...
30
I think that's a little too low, because there's 100 over there. And here, I think we see more than 100. So I think 30 is a little too low. 30 seems to be not such a great estimate today, I'm thinking. So this is, again, macaroni. You can actually do this at home. If you guys want to try practicing estimating, you can do with anything. You count out 10 of something and 100 of something. Macaroni is a great thing to do it with. And then find out about how many you think are in the box before you eat it. Probably it's going to be a lot tidier. This is another secret. When you put a picture, that's a real box of macaroni, but I have to not put the name of the brand on it. So we use a program called Photoshop to block out the name of the real brand, because otherwise you have to pay for the credits, for the property rights for that. So, and here's popcorn kernels, 100, and there's 1,000, and that's how many kernels in a whole jumbo tub of popcorn. So, do you think there's more than 100? Yes? Do you think there's more than 1,000? Maybe. Maybe. It looks like there's an awful lot. It looks about the same to me. It looks like you're getting almost 1,000 kernels of popcorn in your jumbo popcorn, which you should be sharing. You probably shouldn't be eating that all by yourself. Okay. Now, just with our eye training, about how many balloons do we see?
20.
What do you think? 19? Does anybody think we see 100 balloons?
No.
No, because our eyes are getting used to seeing what 100 looks like, and we know that's not 100. We can tell right away that that's something. I think 20 sounds pretty good to me. And as you see, I don't care about the right number. You can actually count. That one's pretty easy to count. This one, how many bicycles do we see lined up? Are there 100?
No.
Not even close, right? Are there more than 10?
Yes.
Yeah. Are there 50? 15? No, there's not 50. Exactly.
14.
How many boats now?
100. 80.
60.
50. We're getting used to estimating. This is... Now here... But are there more here?
10. Yes.
Okay. Way more, right? And then... A great big marching band of people.
200, 300, 200, 300, 300.
Those all sound really good. Now, that was our first strategy. That was just eye training. Now we're going to do another kind of strategy, which I call clump counting, which is you take the picture and you divide it into one little clump. So here's a picture of skydivers. This really happened. This is a real photo. These were people all skydiving at once at the time they broke the world's record for this type of formation skydiving. Now, you can take any one, it's a little easier to see over here, clump of these, and you can actually count. I'm not against counting in all cases. You can start counting 1, 2, 3, 4. Here's 5. 10, 15, 20. Let's say this is about 50 people in this clump here. Then you can skip count. How many of you have done any skip counting? Excellent. You can skip count by 50s, which is pretty easy. 50, 100, 150, 200, 250, 300, 350, 400, 450, 500. There's about 500 people in this formation. Now, we know that 50 was a little high, so we can say, okay, let's subtract a few. Let's say it's about 450. That's a type of estimating you can do like this. That's your clump. You can skip count with any numbers that you're comfortable skip counting with. Counting out 10 is really easy on some. Here's one. Here's a group of balloons. That clump counting is going to work really well on this. You can count out just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. This is about 10, right? So then you can just take your hand and go 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100. Say there's about 100 here. And you can keep going until you get your estimate. One of the things that's important is an estimate doesn't have to be instant. It doesn't have to be your first guess. You can take a little time to do it and to make it better. So the clump counting takes a little longer, but you can get a pretty good estimate that way. Same thing for this. Here's one I put in for Tina. You can count out 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. There's 10 on this shelf. Then you can clump count by groups of 10 to guess how many are on. Now, there is another. The third strategy that I want to talk about is boxing and counting. This is great. Well, we'll find out when it's great. Here, you might look at that and say, that's a lot of beads. There's no way I can, a million, exactly. That's a million. It's just a crazy number of beads. But if you imagine dividing that picture into 100, this is a grid of 100. And now you've got kind of an idea of 100. Imagine that this is an imaginary grid. I drew it on for you. Now all we're going to do is count the beads in any one of these boxes. I'm going to get this one. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 12, 13. Say 14 because there's part of one there. There's 14 in this. Because there's 100, all we have to do is add two zeros. We're actually multiplying by 100, and you get 1,400. And 1,400 is a pretty good estimate of how many beads we see right there. Now that's really amazing, because when you first looked at it, we thought there might be a million. But now we know that a million is kind of too high. 1,400 is probably better. 1,000 is a good estimate, 2,000 is a good estimate. Now, box and count works best. I want to show you two pictures of birds. There's this picture of birds, and this picture of birds. Which picture, number one or number two, do you think box and count is better for? Two? How many people think number one? And how many people think number two? I agree with number two. And I'll show you why. Box and count works really well when the items are evenly scattered across the picture. In this picture of birds, see, if you do box and count, you've got some real empty spaces up there. That's called distribution. The distribution of items is not quite even, so it's not as good a strategy. But on this one, you can put your grid on, and then this one is pretty evenly distributed. You can count the birds in here, and I'm not going to count them all because there's too many, but I'm going to do my clump counting. 1, 2, 3, 4, say that's about 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60. 60, then I'm going to add my two zeros because it's box and count and get about 6,000. So there's about 6,000 birds in this picture. This is another picture where the buildings are really evenly scattered across the whole picture. So if you imagine, you can imagine this grid of 100, count the buildings in one grid, and you'll come up with a really good estimate. This happens to be red blood cells. Red blood cells are in your body all the time. They're very important. And this is a real use of estimation. Doctors count 2 minutes? Okay. Doctors count red blood cells using this kind of estimation under the microscope. So we've got, I want you to learn, oh, actually, we'll do this as our last thing. This is 100. This is 100 beads, okay? Can I get 2 volunteers? You in the red shirt, and you in the stripes? Thank you. Okay. I have 1,000 beads here. Now, I'm going to have you stand at this side of the room. You're going to hold one end. How far do you think 1,000 beads is going to go? Is it going to reach to the end of the ducks?
No.
I mean, will it reach that far? Will it reach the chair?
Yeah, I think longer.
Do you think it'll reach all the way to the door?
No.
Let's find out. Here's an end for you.
Dude, that's gonna go.
This could be like a jump rope.
And
this is gonna go all the way to the chair.
Let's see.
Wait, where's it gonna go?
There we go. And an end for you without the knot. There you go. And walk over that way. Do we reach the chair? Keep going. I think we've got a little farther to go. Right about there. Not too stretchy. So we made it just past the chair. So if we put the beads right there, that's right about where that goes. That was 1,000. You guys, you all knew it was going to go past the chair. So you guys have become much better estimators in just this short amount of time. So if you practice, if you look at the books, you'll get more practice. And you can practice at home, practice with any pictures you see, practice with chairs when you're in a group, when you're bored. I really recommend doing this whenever you feel like it. Thanks for coming. Thanks for your help. Thanks for your help. Yes. Pardon?
I've never been a volunteer for anything. Can I be a volunteer next?
Well, you can be. I don't think you're going to be in the next presentation.
Okay.
But you can be a volunteer to take a duck home. How about that?
All right. Thank you very much for listening to Bruce.